Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon, Shailaja. Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Very good afternoon. Will they join once again, all of your classmates? There are only 21 participants. So yesterday or day before yesterday, there were 82 or 90, something, that number. Will they join?
They will join, ma'am. They will join, ma'am.
Okay. So we will wait for another 2 or 3 minutes. Then we will start. Today, I'm going to eat your brain. Because I have to take up 4 hours.
Okay.
So you should bear with me.
Sure, ma'am.
We will take up the remaining 2 topics of Stanley Fish and Franz Fanon. Those 2 topics are a little difficult to understand. So we will take up the help of the text. So I request everybody, whoever is there now present, please get ready with your textbook. That is, your material, teaching material. Thank you, Anita. Thank you very much. Thank you, Anita. If you will have the textbook, we will go through the main points of the essay for both the topics.
No Stanley Fish topic you will tell, ma'am.
Yes. First, we will take up Stanley Fish. Then we will take up Franz Fanon's The Wretched of the Earth.
Okay, ma'am. Page number could you say, ma'am?
Yeah, definitely. Page number 222, unit 5, 222. Is there a text in this class by Stanley Fish? This is analysis. I'm dealing with the analysis part. First, I will introduce you. Everything I will introduce, and then we will move to the analysis part. Okay?
Okay.
Including me, 24, I think. Then how? They will miss the introductory part and they will find it confusing.
They will join, ma'am.
Okay. I will wait. Whenever you need a break, please let me know. Either you message or unmute yourself and let me know. Okay, then we will have a short break of 5 to 10 minutes. Then once again, we will take up the next topic. Okay, shall we start, dear students?
Yes, ma'am.
See, there was a little confusion, no problem.
Yes, ma'am.
I actually called Anil sir, and sir might have clarified to Ashok sir as well, okay? So without much delay, 42 means the number is rising. Okay. So, first, today I will deal with, in the first session of this afternoon time, I will deal with Stanley Fish. And as I told you, please get ready with your book also, as well as one pen or pencil, so that you underline the most important. Synonyms for the most difficult words, terminology, or any statement. One minute. Sir, chapin, sir.
Madam,
may I
continue?
Please continue, chestnut, sir. Chestnut.
Answer.
Confusion, sir. Later, sir. Exit here, sir.
Ma'am, are you there?
Yes, Shailaja.
Ma'am, are you there?
Yes, yes, Anita, yes, yes. Because sir called once again, so I muted myself. Okay.
Okay. Ma'am, page number 213, ma'am.
No, no, no. Page number 222. Page number 222. 222. Okay. This is unit 5, lesson number 22. An analysis of the text. Is there a text in this class? Question mark. The title we have to analyze. Why there is that specificity, or what are the different meanings which we can draw, which we can derive from the title? Is there a text in this class by Stanley Fish? Okay. First, let me show my presentation. Then we will go into the text one by one. So this main element or Stanley Fish's essay is related to reader response theory. Stanley Fish belongs to one major theory, one major stream called reader response theory, which was very vogue in 20th century, mid of the 20th century. And presently, this particular theory or literary critical theory is much vogue, much in its vogue. Okay. So what is reader response theory? This came as an opposite to, we can give a small one word or two line definition, like this is an opposite theory to new criticism. Opposite theory to new criticism, then extension to post-structuralism, extended to post-structuralism. It has psychoanalytical elements also. So it is a kind of mixture of many other previous theories, literary theories. Now, it is a school. School means one group. It is a school of literary theory. We can also say that of 20th century. 20th century literary theory that focuses on the reader. Means we are coming forward to the present. We are meeting to the present time. In the beginning of Wordsworth's time, it was biographical criticism. Wordsworth, then Samuel Taylor Coleridge, they have all given a lot of importance to the writer. They have given a lot of importance to the biographical elements of the author or any writer or any novelist. Means major focus was given to the author. Then by the time of T.S. Eliot, as we have studied in Tradition and Individual Talent, focus was on the text as a product. Text became independent, or the work of art became independent. It has to be judged. It has to be criticized as an independent entity, but not connected with the author. Right? This we have learned in Tradition and Individual Talent. Text became free. It is a liberal or independent entity. But after New Criticism, or T.S. Eliot's exponent, he is the chief exponent of text-related theory. Next comes reader response theory. Now the focus is even moved away from the text to the reader. Reader becomes the most important entity. Reader's mind becomes the most important entity, and reader's response will decide the fate of the text. Reader's response will decide the fate of the text. So it is a school of 20th century literary theory that focuses on the reader or audience, nowadays we call it as audience, because any work of art means generally we think about movies. So I mean, movies are watched, so there are audience. Audience response is very, very important. Reader of a text or audience of any movie or drama is very important, and their experience of a literary work, how they felt or what did they understand, becomes the most important element related to this literary work. This school is in contrast. What is meant by contrast? Opposite. Okay, this school is in contrast to other schools and theories that focus attention primarily to author. Just now I have explained that in the beginning, at the time of Wordsworth, S.T. Coleridge, author was very important. And then by the time of T.S. Eliot, I.A. Richards, John Crow Ransom, then another important writer is I.A. Richards, T.S. Eliot, John Crow Ransom, Cleanth Brooks also, they gave importance to content and form, means of the text. Where will you find content and form? In the text of the work. This school is in contrast with other schools who gave importance to author or to the text. This theory emerged in 1960s, as I told you, in the mid of the 20th century, 1960s and 70s, particularly in the US and Germany. The birth of reader response theory is in United States of America and in Germany. This movement shifted the focus from the text to the reader, not even author, not even text, but to the reader. Focus is on the reader. That is the reason it is called as reader and his response, and argues that affective response, it is affective response. Generally, don't get little embarrassed. My pronunciation, to remember the difference between these two, what is affective and effective. So my teachers made me to learn like affective and effective. Affective means which has a lot of impact or influence on, and effect means result, as a offspring. Effect, what is the effect? Is the tablet effective? Is the tablet effective? Manchiga panchesinda tablet manchiga, and then result enti adi ela panchesindi body pain, that is effect. Whereas affect, this is affective, means how it influenced or how it has an impact. Now this movement shifted the focus from the text to the reader and argues that affective response is a legitimate point for departure in criticism. Affective response means generally if a reader is affected or influenced by a work of art, it is definitely a legitimate point, means without any doubt, without any illegitimate. What is illegitimate? Means in an indirect way. Here it is direct point for departure in criticism. That particular criticism will be very, very legitimate. Nyayabaddhamainatuvanti పూర్తిగా ఎటువంటి అన్యాయంగా లేకపోతే ఇంపార్షియల్గా ఉండేటువంటి క్రిటిసిజం. ఓకే, నెక్స్ట్, రీడర్ రెస్పాన్స్ థియరీ రికగ్నైజెస్ ద రీడర్ యాజ్ అన్ యాక్టివ్ ఏజెంట్, యాజ్ అన్ యాక్టివ్ పార్టిసిపెంట్ ఆర్ యాక్టివ్ మీడియం హూ ఇంపార్ట్స్ రియల్ ఎగ్జిస్టెన్స్ టు ద వర్క్. హూ విల్ డిసైడ్ ద వర్క్ ఈస్ గుడ్ ఆర్ బ్యాడ్? హూ విల్ డిసైడ్ ద లైఫ్ లాంగ్ ఎగ్జిస్టెన్స్ ఆఫ్ ఎ వర్క్ ఆఫ్ ఆర్ట్? గీతాంజలి ఈజ్ ఏ లైఫ్ లాంగ్ ఎగ్జిస్టెంట్ వర్క్. మెనీ జనరేషన్స్ విల్ రీడ్ ద బుక్ కాల్డ్ గీతాంజలి బై రవీంద్రనాథ్ ట్యాగోర్. వై? ఇట్ ఈస్ నాట్ బికాస్ ఆఫ్ ట్యాగోర్, బికాస్ ద కంటెంట్ which was understood by, which was taken or fixed in the mind of the reader, because readers are enjoying all those poems, definitely it has real existence and completes its meaning through interpretation. There are number of interpretations, number of meanings getting out of that particular poem or that particular collection of poems, that is Gitanjali. Okay, it stands in total opposition to the theories of formalism. Formalism means what? New criticism. which gave a lot of importance to form new criticism in which the reader's role in recreating literary works is ignored. It, because it is supporting the reader, it points out that formalism and new criticism, they ignored the role of reader. New criticism had emphasized, this you have already learned in that particular background topic. New criticism had emphasized that only with, I mean, that which is within a text is part of the meaning of a text. New criticism actually it emphasized that only which is within a text, only which is within a text is part of the meaning of a text. So what new critics generally they emphasized that text will decide its own meaning. Text will decide the form and the content of the text will decide its life. They believed on that, and reader response theory is opposite to it. No appeal to the authority or intention of the author, nor to the psychology of the reader, was allowed in the discussions of the orthodox new critics. Who are orthodox new critics? As I mentioned, they, of course, the pioneers or the critics who laid the foundations of new criticism are T.S. Eliot and I.A. Richards. But after T.S. Eliot and I.A. Richards, there were J.C. Ransom, means John Crow Ransom, Alan Tate, Cleanth Brooks, etc. They are called as orthodox new critics. The classic reader response critics include opposite, means this is one group and this is another group. They are opposites. Orthodox new critics are J.C. Ransom, Alan Tate, Cleanth Brooks. Whereas classic reader response critics are Norman Holland. We will study about them in the essay also. Norman Holland, Stanley Fish, our hero, then Wolfgang Iser, Hans Robert Joss, and Rolla Barthes. Rolla Barthes, you have Death of the Author. Death of the Author essay. In that essay, he, Rolla Barthes, propounded that text as well as reader is very, very important. Death of the Author has one more title, one more hidden meaning called Birth of the Reader. We can say that if there is death of the author, immediately at the same moment, you will have birth of the reader. So that was proved by Rolla Barthes. Okay. Next, what are the types of reader response theory? There are five types of reader response theory. There are multiple approaches within the theoretical branch of reader response criticism. Yet, they are all unified. That is the reason Stanley Fish's this essay has all these approaches, elements in that essay. Is there any text in the class essay, you will find all these, okay? Yet all are unified in their belief that the meaning of a text is derived from the reader. The meaning of the text will be stagnant if there is no reader at all. What is the importance of a text if nobody is reading it? What is the importance of a teacher if she is not teaching any student? If there is a student, there will be a teacher. If there is a teacher, there will be a student. Like that, text and the reader are interdependent. Without reader, there is no text. Without text, there is no reader. So the meaning of a text is derived from the reader through the reading process. This reading process is very important. Okay, now what are the five different approaches? Five different approaches are transactional reader response theory, affective stylistics. I will explain affective stylistics because this was propounded by our Stanley Fish. Subjective reader response theory, psychological reader response theory, and social reader response theory is also by Stanley Fish. Okay, now. Transactional reader response theory was actually propounded by Louis Rosenblatt. She is female. Otherwise, please write down the name. This is the name of a female critic. Louis Rosenblatt is the name of a female critic. Then Wolfgang Iser. Wolfgang Iser is very, very important because Stanley Fish always supported Wolfgang Iser. Then there is, this is transactional reader response theory, affective stylistics. We will focus on this. Affective stylistics is by our hero Stanley Fish. Subjective reader response theory is by David Bleach. Psychological reader response theory is by Norman Holland. And last one is social reader response theory is also extended by Stanley Fish. This response theory is also extended by our Stanley Fish. This is Stanley Fish. Is there a text in the class? Question mark. What is the subtitle? See, subtitle is also very important. The authority of interpretive communities. We have to learn about interpretive communities also. The authority of interpretive communities is called as the subtitle of the main text. Is there a text in this class? Now, what is affective stylistics? Stylistics means something which is related to language. That's the style of the language. Okay. Affective stylistics. This is completely related to our language. Affective stylistics is derived from analyzing further the notion that a literary text is an event. Here, literary text is considered as an event. As a big program that occurs in time. What is an event? Event like marriage, birthday. These are all farewell party, welcome party. These are all like events where we will celebrate, where there is a lot of importance. Here also, affective stylistics is derived from, it comes from analyzing what? The literary text. Analyzing further the notion that a literary text is an event. It is considered as an event that occurs in time, exact time. It occurs exactly at a time that comes into being as it is read. Is it clear? Did you understand? If a perfect event comes for a reader to read a text, that is called as affective stylistics rather than an object that exists in shape. For example, you have in every college, there is a library, right? In that library, what will you find? You will find newspapers, you will find books, varieties of books of many subjects, various kind of subjects, then magazines, journals, right? You will find all those. But what is the use of a library if nobody enters into it? If nobody comes and sit in the class and check with whatever books there are. So if a reader enters into a library, takes a book or journal or newspaper and sits there and reads something in perfection, reads something in peace or with a peace of mind, that particular time is called as event. That particular time is called as one exact event is happening in that library. The text is examined closely in affective stylistics. The text is examined closely, often line by line or even word by word, in order to understand how stylistics means related to language. It affects the reader in the process of reading. This is the actual definition of affective stylistics. The text, any text, whether it is a Telugu text or English text or Urdu text, whatever it is, if you will read often line by line or even word by word, what beautiful words are used by the author. If you will read line by line or word by word in order to understand how it affects. What is stylistics? Stylistics is to understand line by line, word by word, and how these words affect, influence, impact the reader in the process of reading. is called as affective stylistics. How language is affecting the mind of a reader, how different kinds of words or lines they are influencing a reader. Okay, the affective domain includes the manner. The affective domain means region, includes the manner in which we deal with things emotionally, such as feelings, values, appreciation, enthusiasm, motivations, and attitudes. These are all psychological. See, that is the reason I said reader response theory includes everything. Here it is new criticism, where we are studying word by word. Though it is opposite, it is following the method of stylistics. It is analyzing. Reader response theory also analyzes word by word, sentence by sentence. And then psychological also. What is psychological? Because the affective domain includes the manner in which we deal with things emotionally, the reader's mind, the reader's emotions, such as feelings, values, appreciation, enthusiasm, motivations, and attitudes. Is it clear? Did you understand, or do you want me to repeat any one of these slides?
Hello, ma'am. Ma'am, here literary test boring? Means, you know, what it is, ma'am?
What?
Literary test means, you know, it is like metaphors like that, ma'am?
No. Literary text means any kind of work of art. Any.
Story.
Like novel or a non-fiction or a drama or poem or any prose piece, autobiography or biography, any literary text that happens as an event only when, if and only if a reader will start reading it, analyzing it. Otherwise, a literary text is waste. It is zero. There is no meaning. There is no value for that literary text if nobody is reading it. That is the reason I have given you the example of our library. A library is only a room. It is only a storeroom. It is not called as library when nobody enters into it, when nobody takes a book and starts reading it. Here, Stanley Fish says that it is an event. It is a big program. It is a big occasion when somebody enters into a library, takes a book and start reading it. That is called as life of a text. It comes to a life. It is considered as birth of a text when somebody is reading it, or it has certain value. Clear? Did you understand, or do you want me to repeat anything? Is it very boring?
No, madam.
Oh, ma'am.
Okay. So I will pause here. And we will move into the text. What am I doing? Yes. So, as I told you, page number 222. So, what is structure? Structure of the essay is divided into 7 parts. One after the other, we have to deal with that. Okay. In the preceding lesson, you noted that certain reader-oriented approaches to the study of literature came into existence in 1960s. That I mentioned. Even in my PowerPoint presentation, I have mentioned it. Okay. Then, this approach represent a reaction. How many of you are following? This approach, reader response approach, came as a reaction or as opposite. Opposite against what? New criticism, Russian formalism, and structuralism, which assigned a privileged position. Is there any disturbance? Please mute everybody. Please mute.
No.
It is K. Shamala, Arshia Fatima. Please mute. Okay. you will get delayed. Huh. So it came as a reaction against new criticism, Russian formalism and structuralism. For them, information should be author's background or the impact of a literary text on the reader were not relevant. For new critics, Russian formalists and structuralists, the impact, the text's impact on a reader is ignored, or they never gave any value to that influence, that affect on the reader. Whereas our Stanley Fish, he became very much concerned about this affect. He said that, on the other hand, reader-oriented approaches consider that the reader plays an important role. Reader plays an important role in the interpretation of the text. Who will interpret the text, or who will bring out the meaning of the text? It is the reader. So reader must be given a lot of importance. This is their claim, or this they advocated. Better we should say it as advocated. Stanley Fish, along with Wolfgang Iser, Louis Rosenblatt, and others, they have advocated the importance of reader, because the reader is the only person who will interpret the text in varieties of ways. Okay, now of these new reader-centered approaches, there are two. Reception aesthetic of Europe and reader response theory of America are important. As I mentioned in one of my slides, there are this reader response theory has its birth in the US and Germany. Here it is. It is not specifically mentioned. It is here, not as Germany, but as Europe. Reception aesthetic. How many of you are following? Reception aesthetic of Europe and reader response theory of America are important. Okay. First, to the later group, we add Stanley Fish's affective stylistics. For the later group, L-A-T-T-E-R, later group means the next one, that is the U.S. The U.S. group is, reader response theory by Stanley Fish, and he has propounded affected stylistics. Okay, now, let us move to page number 223, third paragraph. Okay, the second paragraph is all about reception aesthetic. I'm not going into those details. Okay, if you want to read, read. Otherwise, let us move to third paragraph. In America, reader response theory, many scholars like Norman Holland, Harold Bloom, David Bleach, and Stanley Fish. That is the reason I am focusing on third paragraph. Okay, Norman Holland, Harold Bloom, David Bleach and Stanley Fish subscribed to the view that a literary text has no, please underline, no absolute or determinate meaning. Underline, Stanley Fish subscribed to the view that a literary text, any text, there you can put, there you can substitute any kind of text, novel, non-fiction, prose piece, poem, anything. Okay, literary text has no absolute or determinate meaning. Please underline that, very important. And several readers respond to the same text in different ways. My interpretation will be different from Nematrahia. My interpretation will be different from Renuka Nagarajan, like that. She will understand in a different perspective. I will understand in a different perspective. It depends. Your views are different from my views. No need. There is no need of having the same kind of response to a movie or to a novel like that. Somebody likes the movie. Somebody doesn't like the movie. Okay, like that. Did you understand? Both Holland, means normal Holland, and Harold Bloom explained that the reader's response to a text is psychoanalytic in nature. Here we have five approaches. As I mentioned in my slides, there are five approaches. So this is one approach. how many of them they have considered reader response is psychoanalytic according to Norman Holland and Harold Bloom, H-A-R-O-L-D, Harold Bloom. Whereas here also there is a differentiation, there is a variation. Holland believed, please excuse me. Okay, oh, I lost my page. Page number 223. We are in page number 223. Is there still confusion, students? Is there still confusion?
No, ma'am.
So there are variations even in reader response theory. Here we have, there is a mention of Norman Holland and Harold Bloom, who explained that the reader response to a text is psychoanalytic in nature, means it depends on the feelings, emotions, or the sentiments which the reader has towards the characters. Okay, characters in a novel or perspective of a fiction, any kind of fiction or non-fiction. Whereas Holland believed that the reader, while reading, identifies himself with the author's fantasies and unconscious urges. Whereas Bloom went a step further and suggested that all reading is only misreading, the difference being between strong reading and weak reading. Confusion, I think. No need of any confusion. Norman Holland said that a reader will identify himself or herself with the dreams of or with the author's fantasies itself. For example, I'll give you one example. While many of you, as there are girls, many of you are girls here, only one or two are boys, many of you. Whenever we see Alice in the Wonderland or Cinderella stories, generally we compare, we imagine ourselves, or we will go into the same fantasies. All these fantasies will make us to compare with that particular heroine. Generally it happens, right? Those who are interesting, those who are highly interested to live in fantasy world, generally we compare the condition of a heroine like Cinderella or Alice in the Wonderland. We think that should happen even in our life. We will compete, or we will try to compare our lives with those fantasies.
Madam, you are mute. Excuse me, ma'am.
One minute, please. Okay, did you understand that line, or do you want me to repeat? Holland believed that the reader, while reading, identifies himself or herself with the author's fantasies and unconscious urges. What we generally not have in our real life, we will have that in our unconscious mind. What psychoanalytical theory propounds, for example, if there are certain desires which are not getting fulfilled, which are not getting, into reality, we generally suppress those desires into our mind. They will go into the deeper layers of our unconscious mind. That is the most important point in psychoanalytical theory. What is that psychoanalytical theory? For example, there are certain desires in our mind, and if they will not get fulfilled into reality, then those desires will be deeply suppressed, will get deeply submerged into our unconscious mind or unconscious layers of our mind. That was actually psychoanalytical aspect. Because society will not accept every desire to come into reality, generally there is a pressure on every individual to suppress these desires. And these desires were actually, mostly there are of sexual desires, which we generally suppress. That was proved by Sigmund Freud in his theory called psychoanalytical theory. He has done his research on the sexual desires, mostly which we suppress. This happens with every individual. Please mute yourself.
Okay. Sorry.
No problem, no problem. Please mute yourself, okay? Then, next, another, Harold Bloom. Who? What is Harold Bloom? I mean, what did he say? Bloom went a step further. Okay, he went a step further and suggested that all reading is only misreading. Whatever we read for the first time will get changed for the second time. It is all misreading. The difference being between strong reading and weak reading. That's it. He says that there is every time a misreading. Only there are two types of reading. What is two types of reading according to Harold Bloom? The first one is strong reading and second one is weak reading. Now, what is strong reading? Strong reading means if a textbook, if it is a storybook, short story book, if it is a Chandamama story, then it is called a strong reading because you focus, because there is no deviation or distraction in your reading. It will influence you. For example, every one of us is interested in story reading, right? I mean, we are highly interested in fairy tales or folklore, these things. And it is called as strong reading. Here it is called as strong reading is called as interesting reading. Whereas weak reading is tedious reading. All our materials, reading materials, they are very tedious reading. We don't like. There is a lot of confusion. There are many distractions. Still, we have to focus only for the sake of marks. I know you will not like my statement, but still, it is called as tedious reading. Why we get exhausted after exams, after writing the last exam, we feel a lot of relaxation. Why all these while it is called as tedious reading, means weak reading. It will not remain for so many days or years in our mind. We will forget. We will forget mostly our materials, I mean, our reading materials. Whereas stories we remember, I mean, after so many years also, that is called as strong reading and weak reading. They might ask you a small, question in that section, A section, the difference between strong reading and weak reading. Write about strong reading and weak reading. You can take up one question, assignment question or assessment question like this. Who propounded strong reading and weak reading? It is Harold Bloom. Okay. Now, next, this important paragraph. One, other critics like Terry Eagleton and Jonathan Culler also stressed the role of the reader in the studying literature, which embodies a process of signification and semiotics. Is it clear? According to Stanley Fish, an informed or competent reader changes the spatial sequence. This is very important. Please underline in that first paragraph itself. After weak reading, there is according to Stanley Fish, an informed or competent reader. Who is an informed or competent or good reader who changes the spatial sequence of the printed text? Spatial sequence of the printed text into a temporal stream of experience. Stream of experience. This is about Stanley Fish. Yes, page number 224. Page number 224. Sumaira Tahseen, it is page number 224, first paragraph and third line, according to Stanley Fish, an informed or competent or good reader. You can also put who is a good reader. A good reader who is or who changes the spatial sequence of the printed text into a temporal stream of experience. Please underline. Now, what is spatial sequence? Means a text in a particular binding, entity, a textbook. What is a textbook? What any book which is printed is called a spatial sequence. Everything is specified. Spatial means which is designed, which is given a proper place. Each and every page is given a place. Index is in one place. Bibliography is in one place. The content is written in one place. About the author's biography is written in one place. Forward or preface is written in one place. This is all the space of a text. This spatial sequence of a text is changed or it is moved by what? Changed into, okay, into what? Stream of your experience. What you are experiencing while reading a book is completely changed. Did you understand? For example, in a novel, there are 10 characters. All these 10 characters you will not like. You will like mostly the protagonist or the heroine or even the antagonist or a comedian in between. These characters will get into your mind as an experience. You are changing the complete spatial sequence of a text in your mind. That becomes your experience. This is propounded by Stanley Fish. Is it clear? Or do you have any confusion? This is only the introductory part we are dealing with. The establishment of reader response theory as a very important, recent theory in 20th century, as a reaction to the previous theories like New Criticism, Russian Formalism, Structuralism, etc. Did I lost you? How many of you are sleeping?
We are following you, ma'am.
Somebody is sleeping. To be frank, if somebody is sleeping, go and wash your face.
To follow, ma'am.
Yes.
Following, ma'am.
Actually, the text I'm not able to follow where it is written, ma'am.
Unit 5. No, ma'am, we are awaking. Okay, very good.
Yes, ma'am,
Unit 5, page number 224.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now we will discuss the text, analysis of the text, 22.3. Clear? We are following, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, Saida. Thank you very much. 22.3. We have completed the introductory part. Even in reader response theory, as I have shown you in my slide, there are varieties: transactional, then we have psychological, then we have affective stylistics, right? Like that, even there are varieties in reader response theory. Basically, the major are Norman Holland, Harold Bloom, Wolfgang Iser, and Stanley Fish. Okay? Now, the analysis of the text, is there a text in this class? Question mark. Means the title itself is a question. Somebody asked, is there a text in the class or in this class? Okay, now let us see. This essay runs into more than 15 pages and the text of the essay is little complicated. It is mentioned, it is accepted that the essay is little complicated, particularly for non-native speakers of English, means all of us. It is very difficult for analyzing or to understand the text for the non-native speakers of English. Therefore, it is useful to consider the text as consisting of 7 parts. For our comfort, for our better understanding, the text is divided into 7 parts, one after the other. Okay, please remember that Stanley Fish belonged to a group of American critics who favored a reader-oriented approach. He will support the reader. He will advocate the reader's flexibility or reader's freedom while analyzing a text. Each individual is a reader and each individual is a separate entity to understand the text or to comprehend the text in his or her own. own ways. మీకు నచ్చినట్టుగా మీరు అనలైజ్ చేసుకోవచ్చు, వేరే వాళ్ళకి నచ్చినట్టుగా వేరే వాళ్ళు అనలైజ్ చేసుకుంటారు. దేర్ ఈజ్ నో రూల్ అట్ ఆల్ దాట్ దేర్ విల్ బి ఏ డిటర్మిన్డ్ మీనింగ్ ఆఫ్ ఎ టెక్స్ట్. ఓకే, ఫర్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ రామాయణ. రామాయణ ఇన్ ఆల్ దీస్ ఇయర్స్, దీస్ ఆల్ ఇయర్స్ వీ హ్యావ్ ఓన్లీ వన్ వ్యూ ఫ్రమ్ ద వ్యూ ఆఫ్ లార్డ్ రామ యాజ్ ద హీరో ఆఫ్ ద ఎపిక్. ఇట్ ఈస్ ఓన్లీ వన్ పర్స్పెక్టివ్. రామ ఇస్ ద లార్డ్ రామ ఇస్ ద సెంటర్ ఆఫ్ ద హోల్ ఎపిక్, ద సెంటర్ ఆఫ్ ద హోల్ స్టోరీ. దిస్ we understood. This is called as determinate meaning. Andarki kuda ilage ardham avvali. All movies, all different other stories were all considered Rama as the center of the whole story. This is called as determinate, means already decided from the beginning that Rama is the hero of the epic. Nowadays, after reader response theory, after this particular bloom, Ravana was also considered as one of the second heroes or one of the central figures of the epic. Sita was also given a lot of importance. Lakshmana, from the perspective of Lakshmana, was also given importance. Like that, every view changes. Clear? Is that clear with this example? So Stanley Fish proposes that, or he claims that every individual is a different entity and they will have their own strength of their own analysis of understanding a text, comprehending a text, and freedom must be given. And they should be given flexibility. They should be given freedom. Nobody should object their analysis. Now, in the first part, Stanley Fish refers to an anecdote, one simple incident. He refers to one small incident of Johns Hopkins University. He was working in Johns Hopkins University, Stanley Fish, where he was a professor of English literature. Okay, he was a professor of English literature. On the first day of a new semester in this university, a female student asked one of the teachers, who is this one of the teachers? His own friend. Okay, Stanley Fish's own friend. He's also one of the colleagues. One student, female student, asked another colleague of Stanley Fish, is there a text in this class? This is her question. Now, this anecdote or this question became the title of the essay. This is from a female student of which university? Johns Hopkins University, where Stanley Fish was working as a professor of English literature. Clear? Now, what is this question? Is there a text in this class? The colleague answered, yes. It is the Norton Anthology of Literature. He gave one title. He gave the title of the text. Norton anecdote means one incident. He begins with giving, one important statement like thing, or like he's giving us one incident as an example. He begins. Means one interesting incident or interesting kind of a real life incident is called as anecdote, which happened in his real life is called as anecdote. Saujanya, is it okay? Anecdote means one small interesting real life incident or which creates a lot of interest in the reader. And the colleague said, yes, it is the Norton Anthology of Literature. Then the student who had just attended Fish's class added, no, I mean, in this class, do we believe in poems and things? Or is it just us? Question mark. Another doubt. She raised another doubt. No. She said, it is. No, I am not asking about any text, not an anthology of literature or any kind. I want to clarify, No, no, I mean in this class, do we believe in poems and things, or is it just us? Us means as one group. Do we have poems and things also, or is it just the issue, or is it just the incidents which we have to discuss? I know you didn't understand. Stanley Fish has given all the analysis. Okay. Therefore, Fish points out that there are dangers of listening to people like himself who advocate that a text does not have a determinate single meaning, and it is its meaning unstable. Every time meaning changes, one perspective is different from another perspective. Is it clear? It doesn't have any determinate or decided meaning previously. Now, page number 225. Page number 225, second part. Why, madam? Why did you skip? Why did I skip? Because in the second part, you will have all the analysis of that question. Okay. In the second part, Fish goes further and suggests the possibility of the third meaning as well. In the first, in page number 224, there are two meanings of the same question. Is there a text in this class? No, no. I mean, sorry, yes, it is not an anthology in literature is one, first meaning. Second meaning is, no, no, I mean, in this class, do we believe in poems and things, or is it just us? That is second. Now, third, he is trying to give us third meaning also. What is that? Stanley Fish goes further and suggests that the possibility of a third meaning to the question asked by the student. Thus, there are three possible meanings. This is very important. You have to read once again. Is there a text in the class, which refers to the first day of the class? Means a very, very normal doubt of a first semester student. First meaning is, with reference to the first day of the class, as a very ignorant girl, she has asked about a text. Okay, that is first meaning. Now, second, is there a text in this class? Two, with a reference to the disputed issues in the contemporary literary theory. This is very important. Already Stanley Fish is having certain issues with M.H. Abrams and other new critics, because reader response theory is against what? New criticism, Russian formalism and structuralism. He is against, means there is an issue. That issue is also called as text. Will you text me in the evening? Sumalata, will you text me in the evening? What does it mean? What is meant by text me in the evening?
Message.
Exactly. You have this, it means you have an understanding of the word, why we are using text, even in our modern life. Text means to message. Correct. That is correct. Like that, there is one more meaning for this community people, for this university people. What is that university people understand about text? Means an issue which is burning between, which is rising between Stanley Fish and M.H. Abrams, one new critic. There is a rivalry between Stanley Fish and M.H. Abrams. M.H. Abrams is a supporter of new criticism, where he gives importance to the text. Stanley Fish is a supporter of reader response theory, where he supports the reader. So the second interpretation of the sentence, is there a text in this class? Is there a rivalry in the class? Is there an issue between two professors in this class? Adidanardam. Clear? The second is little difficult to understand, but it has this hidden meaning also. The girl, the female student, has asked one more professor that, is there a rivalry between two professors? The students, they will have their own fears. whom to support or how to be diplomatic. పిల్లలకి భయం ఉంటుంది కదా, ఇద్దరు టీచర్ల మధ్యలో గొడవ జరుగుతుంటే అయ్యి బాబో ఎవరిని సపోర్ట్ చేయాలో ఏమో, నోరు మూసుకుని ఉంటే మంచిది అనుకుంటారు కదా. లైక్ దాట్ ఈవెన్ దిస్ గర్ల్ ఈస్ ఆల్సో ఆస్కింగ్, ఈస్ దేర్ ఎన్ ఇష్యూ, ఈస్ దేర్ ఎనీ రైవలరీ ఇన్ దిస్ క్లాస్ బిట్వీన్ టూ ప్రొఫెసర్స్. దట్ ఈస్ సెకండ్ వన్. థర్డ్ ఇంపార్టెంట్ మీనింగ్ ఈస్ దేర్ ఎ టెక్స్ట్ ఇన్ దిస్ క్లాస్ మీన్స్ ఇన్ ద కాంటెక్స్ట్ లైక్ ఐ థింక్ ఐ లెఫ్ట్ మై టెక్స్ట్ ఇన్ దిస్ క్లాస్, హ్యావ్ యూ సీన్ ఇట్, నేను నిన్న ఒక పుస్తకం మర్చిపోయానండి అదేమన్నా మీరు చూసారా అని కూడా అడిగింది. దిస్ ఇస్ థర్డ్ మీనింగ్. థర్డ్ పాసిబిలిటీ, దీస్ ఆర్ ఆల్ పాసిబిలిటీస్ ఆఫ్ అండర్స్టాండింగ్ ఏ సెంటెన్స్, ఆఫ్ అండర్స్టాండింగ్ వన్ స్మాల్ సెంటెన్స్. హీ హాస్ గివెన్ ఓన్లీ వన్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ ఆఫ్ వన్ సెంటెన్స్. ద ఫస్ట్ వన్ ఈస్ ఈస్ దేర్ ఎ టెక్స్ట్ ఇన్ దిస్ క్లాస్ మీన్స్ విచ్ ఈస్ రిఫరింగ్ టు ద ఫస్ట్ డే బికాస్ షీ ఈస్ ఎ వెరీ వెరీ న్యూ కమర్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ ఫస్ట్ సెమిస్టర్. దిస్ ఈస్ ఎ వెరీ క్వైట్ నార్మల్ డౌట్ ఫర్ ఎనీ స్టూడెంట్. సెకండ్ వన్ ఈస్ దేర్ ఎ టెక్స్ట్ ఇన్ దిస్ క్లాస్ మీన్స్ ఈస్ దేర్ ఎనీ రైవలరీ బిట్వీన్ టూ ప్రొఫెసర్స్ డిస్ప్యూట్ ఇష్యూయింగ్ ఇన్ ద కంటెంపరీ లిటరీ థియరీ బిట్వీన్ టూ ప్రొఫెసర్స్ టూ వ్యూస్ టూ స్కూల్స్ న్యూ క్రిటిసిజం స్కూల్ అండ్ రీడర్ రెస్పాన్స్ థియరీ స్కూల్. Third one is there any, is there a text in this class? Yesterday I forgot my text in this class. Did you find that or have you seen it? This is third interpretation. So this proves, Stanley Fish proves that every utterance has an infinite plurality of meanings. Infinite, plurality of meanings means various kinds of meanings you can draw from any sentence. This is a particular meaning is evoked not by the linguistic system. Don't think that it is because of the words which are arranged like that. No, but by the state, situation, or context in which an utterance is produced or heard. For example, in our university campus or in our colleges, students, teachers, they will have one particular kind of language. They will talk in a code language. Students, they will have a code language that is called as slang. That is called as slang language. Students, they will use one particular kind of vocabulary, one particular kind of language. That is called as student language, which will, what is, for example, the actual word for a two-wheeler is called as motor bicycle. The actual means if you have to say, you have to say as motor bicycle. Bicycle which is fixed with a motor is called as motor bicycle. But nowadays it is called as bike, B-I-K-E. It is a slang word. It is a short form, clipped word that is called as clipping. We will clip it. Means that particular vocabulary is only understood by a community, which he calls it as an interpretive community. He calls, Stanley Fish calls as an interpretive community, where same kind of language, once again, I will share my screen so that you will understand what is interpretive community. After stylistics, see? Interpretive community means a particular kind of language which is used or which is understood by one single community. I have given you the example of student community. Student community generally have one kind of vocabulary or word, or language. For example, don't get me wrong. Nowadays, students generally they have one. Kind of a thing called pulihar kalpadam antar. Okay, I think many of you get surprised. Pulihar kalpadam means talking with a girl, flirting with a girl, and trying to impress her, trying to have a very good attachment with her, passing the time or impressing. This is called as pulihar kalpadam. Beyond that community, people will not understand it. Generally, older people or young, very, very present kids, they cannot understand, because that particular phrase is specifically meant for one community. That community people only will understand. Okay, do you know other elderly people will understand about assignments? Assignments for elderly people means the assigned work, the prescribed work to be done. Whereas assignments for all of us means which will gain certain internal marks, where you have to write, copy from one book to another book. You have where we have to fill the pages and should attain marks is called as assignments. Our interpretation for the word assignments is different, whereas for elderly people assignments is different. Assignment means for them it is an assigned work, which is a important work to be done within a time, whereas for us assignments are mark gaining things. We will gain certain marks. So like that, it is interpretive community. Stanley Fish situates the reading process within a broader institutional perspective. In his seminal work, Is There a Text in the Class, which is published in the year 1980, Fish proposes that competent readers or good readers form part of interpretive community. They will form these competent readers. Please mute yourself. Competent readers form part of interpretive communities. Good readers, they will form part of interpretive community. This group consists of members who share interpretive strategies. They will share what interpretive strategies means. They will have same kind of interpretation, this community, or a set of community assumptions of reading a text so as to write meaning into it. Okay, Fish suggests that interpretation of a literary text is characterized not by fixed meanings. Interpretation of a literary text is not by fixed meanings in a linguistic system. It will go on changing. The meanings are unstable. One day it will be one meaning. Next day the meaning will change. It is interpreted by the practices and assumptions of an institution or a community. Whereas meanings are derived from a context that imparts meaning to an utterance from its context. As contexts change, meanings will also change. Context means the events in which particular time we are living. If that is changing, meaning will also change. For example, I will give you one social context. In olden days, around 20 or 30 years back, selecting a boy by ourselves to marry is considered as a sin, is considered as a violation. Violation of a family. Suppose I want to marry of my own choice a boy, then it is considered as some kind of abnormality or some kind of violation of family rules in that context. Nowadays, the context changed. Parents are asking girls to find their own boys, find their own partners. Our context is now changed. 21st century context is completely changed. Now it is not considered as violation. It is considered as liberation. It is considered as, okay, if you want to marry somebody, find out. Find your own boy. Let us live each other's life. Meer high ga undandi, mammalu high ga unchandi antaru. The context is changing. The meanings are changing. It is by interpretive community. Is it clear? Did you understand? Now, another. Let me. No, I have to tell you about. Yes, page number 226. Page number 226. Fish calls institutional nesting. Institutional nesting. Please underline. Paragraph 3. It is paragraph 3. Fish calls this institutional nesting. What is institutional nesting? Let us see. Which provides a prospective to hear or read utterances or sentences. That is, this normal category is not transcendental, but institutional, because no institution is universally in force that its status as a normal category lasts long. Maybe they will ask for a short question in your exams. What is institutional nesting according to Stanley Fish? You have to write these points. Okay. According to Stanley Fish, the category of the normal, it is in columns, the category of the normal is not transcendental. It is institutional. It is not transcendental, unseen. Transcendental means unseen, but it is institutional. The term institutional has two implications. Mainly institutions lo two varieties. What are these two implications? First, some institutions are short-lived institutions. Like one party, which is short-lived and limited scope, political party or youth party, which is short-lived and have limited in scope. Secondly, others are long-living and comprehensive. Some parties are long-living and very, very comprehensive also. Meanings related with the second are stable. Secondly is long living institutional nesting. Institutional nesting, which is long living, meanings related with the second are stable and normally and naturally available. They are available in every day-to-day life. Some meanings which are unchanged, they are called as long living and comprehensive institutional words. The second institutional implication consists of widely shared understanding of ordinary language. Mostly this happens with ordinary language. Meaning is always contextual. Our meanings depend on the event. Okay, for example, death. The word death, it is used in varieties. It has number of synonyms which we have to use in different occasions, in different events. It is contextual. For example, somebody died around 10 years back or 20 years back, and we call he expired or he passed away like that. He passed away like that. Expired, passed away are words generally we use. Suppose a person who died yesterday or just within hours, we say it is he breathed his last. Like that, according to the context, meanings will change, words will change, institutional nesting will change, and the usage will change. All these are related to death. Am I right? Expired, passed away, breathed his last, like that. These are all connected to somebody's death or end. But meanings generally, they always change according to the context. They are not determinate. Determinate are meanings which are stable, normal, and they are long living. An utterance has different meanings in different contexts. So just as I have given you one example, an utterance will have, has different meanings in different contexts. Do you have any doubt?
No, ma'am.
Please let me know.
Madam, here meaning is contextual, means according to the situation or according to the context, meaning different.
According to the situation, according to the, the thing which we are trying to express, what is the place, what is the context, or who are the people who are listening to us? if are they small kids, for small kids we will explain it in a different way, right? For elder, I mean, for matured students, we will express it in different ways. Like that, according to the context, according to the age also of the students, we will change. Yes, anything else? Shall we move forward?
Ma'am, here a new criticism also is a reader response theory, no, madam. Matlab, you know, they have came up with the points that, you know, they have given importance to the readers.
No, new critics didn't give importance to the readers. They gave importance only to the text as an independent entity. Whereas Stanley Fish and other reader response critics, they gave importance to the reader. They moved further, and they gave importance to the reader. Clear? Or do you want me to explain?
Ma'am, clear, madam. Thank you.
See, is it Jyoti? Somebody asked. Okay, I forgot your name. See, new critics or structuralists or formalists, they gave importance to the form, any form, whether it is a text or painting or any kind of sculpting, anything, they gave importance to form. They felt that everything, whatever is in this universe, has a format and we have to follow that. Structuralism came from linguistics, means from language, especially from language, whereas post-structuralism came from philosophy. That is different and this is different. Now, reader response theory, we can say that it is an extension of new criticism. New criticism stopped at the text only. They didn't give any value to author. They didn't give any value to reader. They felt that text is itself as an independent entity and it has its own importance. But reader response theory said that without a reader, there is no text. Without a reader, the text will not have any kind of importance. It is zero. When there is nobody to explain, when there is nobody to comprehend, what is the value of a text? What is the value of an author? Nothing. So reader is very important, who gives life to the text as well as to the author. Otherwise, without a reader, these two are zero. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Anybody, not only the girl who asked me the doubt, anybody? What about others? Shall we move forward? Please respond.
No doubt, ma'am.
Okay, if there is no doubt, we will take up. Yes, page number 228.
Yes, ma'am, you can move ahead.
Okay, Arshia, thank you. So, page number 228. Okay, in page number 228, in conclusion, that is the seventh part, he says that he summarizes his arguments against the charges made by M.H. Abrams, Hirsch, one more critic, and others about pluralism, relativism, and solipsism. What is solipsism? Please write down there, solipsism. Solipsism means the quality of being self-centered, means egoistic or egocentric. Solipsism means the quality of being self-centered. How human beings or any meaning is self-centered. Here, Stanley Fish summarizes his arguments against, means as a reaction against M.H. Abrams, who is a new critic, Hirsch is also a new critic, and others about pluralism, relativism and solipsism of interpretation of utterances in normal communication and of texts of literature as follows. He has given three important points. What are these? Communication does occur. Okay, we believe that communication always occurs. In spite of the absence of an independent and context-free system of meanings, communication generally it happens despite or in spite of the absence of an independent and context-free systems of meanings. Sometimes without any context also we talk. Still there is a meaning. There is no need to talk about every time related to a context. There are sometimes absence of a context also. Those who participate in this communication do so confidently rather than provisionally. People who participate in this non-context meetings also, non-context communications also, still confidently they will communicate. This happened even in Waiting for Godot, right? Even in Waiting for Godot, there is, in that drama, there is communication happening without any context. There is nothing actually to talk. This is theater of the absurd, right? In theater of the absurd, everything is vague. Everything is nonsense. Vague means what? I mean, absurd means what? Vague or unclear. What is the most important quality of theater of the absurd? There is nonsense prevailing on the stage. There is a lot of, uncontextual talk. There is no plot in the drama. Still, communication happens. The communication between Vladimir and Estragon, they talk nonsensical things. They actually, it is not important. They can be silent also. They can sit silently, but still they try to talk. They are communicating. This is one example. Okay, last point. While their confidence has its source in a set of beliefs, those beliefs are not individual, specific or idiosyncratic, but communal and conventional. Yeah, communal and conventional. This essay thus ends on a positive note. Stanley Fish, because he has proved his point, this essay ends on a positive note, as Fish says, in short, my message to them, them means M.H. Abrams, Hirsch, and the supporters of New Criticism, supporters of determinacy of meaning, is finally not challenging, but consoling. I'm consoling them, not to worry, not to take it very seriously. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
See, Stanley Fish, as a reader response theorist, he wanted to establish, he wanted to prove that the words, according to the context or even without a context, doesn't have determinate meaning. They always change. They always change according to the moods of the reader, according to the context of the reader in which he or she is reading. Okay? Now, please let me know.
Okay, ma'am.
Is it clear?
Ma'am, it's clear, ma'am.
Students joined. Why only 75 students joined? Yesterday or the day before yesterday, there were many students. Many students in the sense, 89 or 90 students were there. Okay, no problem. But it is a very difficult topic. See, Stanley Fish's topic is a very dry subject, and you have to please read. You please read this analysis, this part, not the previous part. If you read the previous part, you will become more confused. Better you add my PowerPoint presentation. My PowerPoint presentation is also according to the meanings, affective stylistics, what is institutional nesting, what is interpretive community, like that I have defined for check. Okay, so please do read these parts, first part, second part, third part, like that. Then you will be able to write Stanley Fish easy. Or if you want me to prepare a notes for all of you also, that is also okay. I will prepare. And I will post it in your group as a PDF.
Yes, ma'am.
Document.
Thank you, ma'am.
But thank you, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Because I have to deal with first year class also. Please give me time. Then I will prepare one easy notes so that you will write point wise in the examination. Dhanadhan. Like that. Please give me time to prepare an essay.
Okay, ma'am.
For assignments, you could depend on this material. For assignments, for self-assessment questions or anything like that, you depend on this text. For final answer, for the sake of final year exams, I will give you one long question easily so that you will write it. Then, okay?
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. This is all about Stanley Fish's is there any text in the class? It has three meanings, three derived meanings in it. Okay? Who is this? Ma'am, you are so kind. Yes, Saida, because I know the level of difficulty, I want to make it easy for all of you to remember these points. See, generally, student psychology is like that. Something which is very difficult, they will simply leave it. They will skip it. Or they will try to forget it. Or though they will read, they will by heart and put it on the paper and just forget. This is not... See, PG syllabus, all PG topics, they are to remember. These are very important topics which are prescribed in your syllabus. So you have to study it with a lot of interest. And it is my responsibility to make it interesting. That is the reason I am trying. I'm saying that I will give you one proper notes so that you will study it with interest.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
As Stanley Fish said, that there are serious readers and tedious readers. You should not be a tedious reader. You should be a serious, happy reader. So that
yes, ma'am.
Strong reader.
Strong reader, serious reader, good reader. Like that, okay. Next, do you want me to give some break or shall I continue with the remaining work? Franz Fanon's The Wretched of the Earth. Very difficult. This is also very difficult. Yes.
Break, ma'am.
Reshma is asking for a break. How much time do you want me to give the break? 5 minutes. Is it okay if I'll give break for 5 minutes?
Okay, madam.
But please, madam, you are making us strong readers, madam. Thank you so much. Yes, thank you, Uma. Thank you, Uma. Very good. Thank you. Suresh, do you have any doubt? You said only madam. Do you have any doubt? Do you want me to clarify any doubt? Suresh.
Ma'am, I have sent some other message earlier, madam.
Thank you for your concern. Okay. Thank you very much for your concern. It's an opportunity. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Suresh. I thought you are asking me any doubt or anything. Okay. Please take a break and join. Join.
Thank you.
Ma'am, 5 minutes or 10 minutes?
It's your wish. But it will take a lot of time. Wretched of the Earth will take a lot of time. Please.
Ma'am, this is Radhika.
Yes, Radhika.
Yeah, ma'am, is there any common point between criticism, the Stanley Fish text, or post structuralism, or something? Any common thing?
Yes, yes, Radhika, they are all connected. These theories are all connected. Like we can say, formalism. First, we have to talk about, to understand all these literary theories, the basis is Russian formalism. Okay?
Yes, ma'am, yeah.
It is in Russian formalism, which gave a lot of importance to form. Okay, then from Russian formalism, we got structuralism, which is completely linguistic or related to our literature. It is completely related to linguistics, means arts, all the arts. Whereas post-structuralism is a philosophical. Okay, this is a philosophical. From post-structuralism only we have feminism as a spring or as another stream. So Overall, Radhika, we can say that all these theories or all these critical theories generally have the connection somewhere or the other connection which got deviated. They got deviated. That's it. Views kalavaka. నా వ్యూస్ తోటి నీ వ్యూస్ కలవకపోవచ్చు అందుకని నువ్వు వేరే స్ట్రీమ్ లోకి వెళ్తావు అంతే బట్ యాక్చువల్లీ అవర్ రూట్స్ ఆర్ ద సేమ్ లైక్ దాట్ ఆల్ దీస్ 20th సెంచురీ యాక్చువల్లీ వీ కెన్ సే దాట్ 20th సెంచురీ లిటరీ క్రిటిసిజం దే ఆర్ ఫ్రమ్ రష్యన్ ఫార్మలిజం ఈస్ ద బేసిస్ టు అండర్స్టాండ్ ఆల్ దీస్ వీ హ్యావ్ టు అండర్స్టాండ్ రష్యన్ దేర్ ఈస్ వన్ మోర్ కాల్డ్ డీఫెమిలియరైజేషన్ ఆల్సో In between structuralism and post-structuralism, there is de-familiarization, deconstruction. These theories, short-lived theories are also there.
Okay.
Yeah. But in your syllabus, major theories are prescribed, like new criticism, structuralism and post-structuralism, then psychoanalytical theory and reader response theory, right? So these four or five theories are very major. In between, to understand the connectivity or to understand the gaps, you have to understand what is defamiliarization and then deconstruction also.
Okay.
So that is the reason sometimes we'll get confused. Haripriya, next class, you please focus on the next class. Whatever is gone, okay. You can take, classes or certain hints from your friends, Haripriya. But now we will start Franz Fanon's The Wretched of the Earth. It is short time, okay, short period, just for 5 minutes. No problem, Haripriya. At least now you can focus. What is this?
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes, yes, Swapna. Yes,
ma'am. Is there a way to a technique just to remember the poets' names associated with the respective topics, ma'am, respective novels, ma'am?
Yes, yes.
Any technique?
How to remember the names?
Okay. Any
you can remember. Yes, you can remember according to their age. Age in the sense. According to your title of your paper, like for example 20th century literary English literature, you have 20th century literature means from poetry you have W.B. Yeats, Ted Hughes, Philip Larkin, T.S. Eliot, like that you can remember, and their work. That is one method. Second method is you can remember with according to their contemporaries also. Who are the, for example, century Shakespeare. Along with Shakespeare, who are the contemporaries? Like that, you can draw a picture in your mind. Like we have Ben Jonson, than other like Dr. Marlon, University of Wits, even Philip Sidney, then Edmund Spencer, like that contemporaries to William Shakespeare. So you can remember.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
No problem. No problem. Hello. Somebody raised a hand. What is somebody raised their hands? Do you have any doubts? Okay, by mistake, I think.
Ma'am, this is Swapna again, ma'am.
Yes, Swapna.
Ma'am, just a generic doubt, ma'am.
Yes.
Usually, as an evaluator, while assessing the answer,
yes,
assessing the answer in the exam, what are the parameters usually an examiner looks at, ma'am? It could be an essay or a...
There is nothing very much serious. Generally, an evaluator will check whether the answer is apt to the question given. Means if there is something which is asked to discuss the views of Stanley Fishkin, is there any text in the class? Means you have to write in a discussion form, means what he has discussed. That means we are not asking, or the evaluator is not asking you to write everything about the essay. What are the main points which he has discussed to prove his point, to prove his important statement? That's it we are asking. So aptness, question related answer rasara ledha chustaru. Adi first thing. Ledu question related answer rayaledu ante at least ఆ ఎస్ఏ కి సంబంధించిన పాయింట్స్ అన్ని పెట్టారా లేదా అనేది చూస్తారు. ఇఫ్ యువర్ క్వశ్చన్ ఇఫ్ యువర్ ఆన్సర్ ఈస్ కంప్లీట్లీ రిలేటెడ్ టు ద సేమ్ టాపిక్ కంప్లీట్లీ మీన్స్ ఎవ్రీ టాపిక్ ఈస్ ఎవ్రీ పాయింట్ ఈస్ మెన్షన్ వాట్ ఎవర్ వీ హ్ డిస్కస్డ్ ఇన్ ద క్లాస్ ఇఫ్ ఇట్ ఈస్ మెన్షన్ దెన్ ఆల్సో యూ విల్ గెట్ గుడ్ మార్క్స్. ద థింగ్ జనరలీ స్టూడెంట్స్ విల్ డంప్ ఎవ్రీథింగ్ ఇన్ putting everything, whatever they remember, or sometimes they will mix the views. That also gives them very much more.
Ma'am, can you mute Kavita? Okay, she, I think it's a long time she's been there.
Whose phone is that? Or whose device is that?
Kavita.
Okay. Please let her know.
You can, I think you can mute her.
Myself? Mute all. Okay. Everybody on mute. Array.
Ma'am.
Okay. Swapna.
Ma'am, one moment.
Okay.
No, while developing the answer in the paper, like introduction, the plot, yes, something, yes, like that. Is there any, like, would those headings matter, ma'am?
Yes, definitely. And moreover, it will appeal. It will give a good appeal to the answer. And while reading with the subheadings or anything, it will also help you to remember the answer.
Okay, ma'am.
So subheadings are very important. Subheadings to remember the answer is very important. While writing also, if you will divide your answer with subheadings, it is very appealing to the evaluator as well.
Okay, ma'am. So likewise, introduction is one of the, would be one of the headings.
Yes, introduction, then context, then the most important main points of the essay, then his or her serious arguments or serious focus on which particular aspect, and then conclusion, positives and negatives. Also, you can discuss.
Okay, ma'am.
For example, a question is given, evaluate your views, or what is your point of view? Means, for example, a choice is given to the writer, means the student. Then whatever you find positives in T.S. Eliot, or whatever you have find negative, you can also project. That means your view, you are given freedom to put your view also.
Oh, okay.
Yes, you can do that. If you have liked the essay, you can write all the positives. Why did you like the essay? In which way you are agreeing with T.S. Eliot? Also you can put. If you are not agreeing with T.S. Eliot, why? Also you can. That is evaluate. Evaluate your point of view. That is evaluation. Means somebody is asking you to evaluate T.S. Eliot's Tradition and Individual Talent essay. Means you are given freedom. You can write even like that.
Okay. Okay, ma'am. Okay. Thank you.